Hey guys, welcome to yet another interesting session by Intellipaat, and today we're going to look at logistic regression. So we'll start off by understanding what exactly is regression, then we'll understand what is logistic regression, and finally we'll implement the concept of logistic regression in R. So let's get started. Let's take the scenario where we have three employees. So the first employee is Sam, whose age is 20 and earns $50,000. Next is Bob, who is 35 years old and earns $75,000. And the third employee is Matt, who is 50 years old and earns $100,000. Now, I'll introduce a new employee to you whose age is 28 and ask you what is his salary. What would you do? You would look at the general trend between the age and salary and understand that as age of the employee increases, his salary also increases. Well, this is nothing but regression. We are trying to understand how does a person's age affect his salary based on the historical data. So over here, salary is the dependent variable and age is the independent variable. That is, we're trying to ascertain the salary of the employee with respect to the age. Let's look at the second scenario. Here we have two students, Rachel and Ross. They appear for an exam and Rachel manages to pass the exam while Ross fails. Now, what if another student, let's say Monica, takes the same test? Would she be able to clear the exam? Well, you'll again look at the data provided to you and see that Rachel, being a girl, was able to pass the exam while Ross, being a guy, failed to clear it. And on the basis of this data, you'd see there is a good probability for Monica to clear the exam as well. So this again is regression, where you're finding out if the student has cleared the exam based on the gender. And hence, result is the dependent variable over here, and gender is the independent variable. So in simple terms, regression helps you to understand the extent of relationship between two variables. So now that we've understood what exactly is regression, it's time to understand logistic regression. So logistic regression is a regression technique where the dependent variable is categorical. That is, we determine the probability of the observation belonging to a particular category. So let's look at an example to understand this better. Over here, we're trying to determine the probability of rain based on independent variables such as temperature and humidity. Or in other words, we're choosing a category, namely yes or no, for the question, will it rain? So this is logistic regression for you. Right, now we'll head on and understand the difference between logistic regression and linear regression. In linear regression, we fit a straight line. That is, for a given value of x, there definitely exists a y value which falls on the line. Or in other terms, we can say that there is a linear relationship between the y variable and the x variable. So you can take the example of an employee's salary and age. So let's say the x-axis denotes the employee's age and y-axis denotes the employee's salary. So as the employee's age increases, the employee's salary would also increase linearly. So this is linear regression, but what happens in logistic regression is the dependent variable is categorical, and hence the dependent variable can only have two values, that is either 0 or 1. Now let's understand this better. So let's say over here the x-axis denotes the number of runs scored by Virat Kohli and the y-axis denotes whether Team India has won the match or not. Let's say this line over here denotes 50 runs. So what we can see from this graph is, if Virat Kohli scores more than 50 runs in a match, then there is greater probability for Team India to win the match. And if Virat Kohli scores less than 50 runs in the match, then there is a good probability that India might lose the match. So let's actually take these two points over here. So let's say this is around 50 runs or 49 runs. Let's say if Virat Kohli scores 49 runs in the match, then the probability of India winning the match would also be around 48% or 50%. Now let's take this. So let's say this is around 60 odd runs. So let's say if Virat Kohli scores 60 runs, then the probability of India winning the match would be around 70% or 75%. Right. So in linear regression, we have a straight fit line, and in logistic regression, we have an S-curve. So this S-curve gives us the probability of the result being true or false. So it's finally time to implement the concept of logistic regression with R. So let's go ahead and do that. So we'll be working with the empty cars dataset to implement logistic regression. So let's head to our studio. Right, so this is how our studio looks like. So let's have a glance at the empty cars dataset first. So I'll say view of empty cars. Right, this is our dataset. Now let's understand this properly. So this is our dataset which has 32 observations, or in other words, we have 32 cars, and these are the variables. So MPG is the miles per gallon, SIL is the number of cylinders in car, this is displacement, then we have horsepower, then we have rear axle ratio, the weight of the car, Qsec, VS being whether the engine is V-shaped or straight, AM is for the transmission of the car, gear is number of forward gears, and carb is number of carburetors. So in this example, we would try to determine whether the car has a V-shaped engine or a straight engine based on other variables. So let's go ahead and do that. So in the first case, I would want to determine whether the car has V-shaped engine or straight engine with respect to the mileage of the car. So let's go ahead and do that. To build the logistic regression function in R, we'll be using the GLM function. So over here, the GLM function takes in three parameters. First is the formula. So over here in the formula, we have stated VS tilde MPG. That is, VS is our dependent variable and MPG is our independent variable. So whatever variable is given on the left side of the tilde symbol would be our dependent variable, and whatever variables are given on the right side of the tilde symbol would be the independent variables. So we are trying to determine the type of engine of the car with respect to the miles per gallon of the car. Right, so this was our first parameter. The next is obviously the data set which we are going to give. So the data set is empty cars, and the third parameter is the type of regression technique. So the type of regression technique used over here is binomial. That is, we are going to have just two values, either 0 or 1, and we'll store this result in model 1. So we have successfully built the model. Now let's analyze this model. And to analyze this model, I'll say summary of model 1. So this was the model which we built, and we have some values over here. So let's understand these values properly. So I'll start with these three values over here. So we have null deviance, residual deviance, and AIC. So what is null deviance? So in simple terms, null deviance gives up the accuracy of the model when the independent variable is just the intercept. Or in other words, we are trying to determine whether the car has V-shaped engine or S-shaped engine without any variables or without any independent variables. So when we are not including any independent variables, then the deviance is 43. Now it needs to be kept in mind that the null deviance or any sort of deviance should be as less as possible. Now when we include this one variable in the formula, then we get the residual deviance. So when we include MPG into the formula, then we see that the deviance has decreased from 43 to 25, and we also see that the degrees of freedom have decreased from 31 to 30. So degrees of freedom is nothing but the number of observations minus 1. So the number of observations in empty cars dataset were 32, thus the number of degrees of freedom is 31. Now when we include another variable over here, the degrees of freedom reduces by 1 again, and we get it to be 30. So basically the point that I'm trying to say over here is, initially the null deviance, that is when we are not including any variable, then the null deviance is 43. When we include the variable MPG into this formula, then the residual deviance decreases, and we get the residual deviance to be 25. So this is null deviance and residual deviance. Then next we have AIC. So AIC basically stands for Echaic Information Criteria. Now this is helpful when we are comparing 2 to 3 models with respect to each other. So in simple terms, basically the lower the value of AIC, the better the model. Right. So these were the three values. Now let's actually understand these values over here. So this over here which you see, so MPG, then the estimate is 0.4304. That is, with every 1 unit change in the miles per gallon value we have, we see 0.43 units of change in the logit value of VS. Since because it's logistic regression, so we see that with every 1 unit change, there is 0.3 units of change in the logit value of VS. Now, this is the most important value over here, which is the p-value. So, with the help of p-value, we try to determine whether this variable is significant or not. So, these codes which you see over here, so if we just have one dot over here, then that would mean that the variable is 95% significant. If we have one star, then that would mean that that is 95% significant. If we have two stars, then it would mean that the variable is 99% significant. And if we have three stars, then it would mean that the variable is 99.99% significant, right? And since we see that MPG has two stars over here, then it is significant with a confidence interval of 99%. Right, so we have built the model over here. Now it's time to check the accuracy of the model. So what we'll do is we'll predict this on some other data set. So let's go ahead and predict these values. So now to predict the values on some other data set, we'll be using the predict function. This again takes three parameters. So the first parameter is the model which you built. Next takes in the independent variables. So over here, since the independent variable which we had was MPG, so we'll take this MPG and create a data frame out of it, which will just comprise of one row. That is, we are trying to determine whether the car will have V-type engine or S-type engine with respect to the MPG when it is 20. And we'll say type is equal to response because we need the probability of it. Right. So the probability of the engine being V-shaped is 0.44 or 44% when the MPG value is 20. Right. Now what I'll do is I'll give a set of values ranging from 20 to 30. That is, the miles per gallon value would start from 20 and then we'll go like 21, 22, 23 to 30. Now let me determine what would be the probability of the engine being V-type with respect to these values. Right, so what we see over here is as the MPG value increases from 20 to 30, we also see that the probability of the engine being V-type increases. So the probability is increasing from 44% to 98%, and this is the maximum over here. So when the miles per gallon value is 30, then there is 98% probability that the engine is of V type. Now, instead of miles per gallon, let me take another column to determine whether the engine is of V type or S type. So now I'll be taking the HP column. So this time the formula will be VS tilde symbol HP. That is, the dependent variable is VS and the independent variable is HP. Or in other terms, I'm trying to determine whether the engine type is V or S with respect to the horsepower of the car. Again, the data used is empty cars and family is binomial because I want a logistic regression for this. So I'll store this in model 2. Now let me compare the summary of model 1 and model 2 and let me determine it properly. So model 1 and similarly summary of model 2. Right. So let me first start off by comparing the AIC values of these two. So AIC value of model 1 is 29 and AIC value of model 2 is 20. That is, second model is much better and significantly better than model 1 because the AIC value reduces by almost 9 units. And similarly, if we look at the null deviance over here, so null deviance is same. That is when we are not including any variable in the formula. But when we go ahead and include the variable, so over here in the model 1, we included MPG and in model 2, we included HP. So when we included horsepower, there is a greater reduction in residual deviance. Or in other terms, we can say that HP is more significant than miles per gallon. Right. So again, let us go ahead and predict some values with respect to horsepower. Right now, I'd want to determine whether the engine is V-type or S-type when the horsepower is 150 units. Right, so again, three parameters. First is the model which we built, which is model 2. Next is the data frame or the set of input values. And we are just giving one horsepower value over here. Type is response because we would need the probability. Right, so the probability of the engine being V-type is just 12%. Now this is quite low. So what we'll do is we'll give a set of values now and determine how does horsepower affect the type of engine. So this time I am giving three values for horsepower. The first value is 150, second value is 100, third value is 50. So what we see is as horsepower decreases, there is a greater probability for the engine be of V type. So over here, if horsepower is 150, then most probably this type of car has a straight engine. And if the horsepower is 50 units, then most probably this type of car has a V type engine. Right. So this is how we determined whether the engine has, whether the engine is V type or S type with respect to the horsepower. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to include both the horsepower and MPG into the same formula and see what happens. So this is my third model over here, where the formula over here is this. So again, VS is the dependent variable and HP and MPG are the independent variables. That is, I want to determine how would these two variables combined would affect the type of engine used in the car. And again, data is empty cars and the family is binomial because I'm building a logistic regression model and I'll store this in model 3. Right now, let me check out the summary of this model as well. So I'll say summary of model 3 and let me have a look at this. Summary 3, summary 2. Right, so that's summary of model 2, and next we have summary of model 1. So let me start off by checking the Fisher score. So let me start off by checking the AIC values over here. So for model 1, AIC value is 29. For model 2, AIC value is 20. And for model 3, which is over here, the AIC value is 22. So what we see is AIC value is the best for the model 2. Now let's understand the model 3 properly over here. So what we see is when we include HP and MPG, both of them in the same formula, now just HP is the only variable which is significant and MPG or miles per gallon is not adding anything of value to the model. And that is why when we compare model 3 and model 2, if we just include HP, that is a much better model. So including MPG into the model with HP is just deteriorating the accuracy of the model. Thus, we can basically conclude from all three of these is that model 2 is the best fit model. Or in other terms, if we want to determine whether the car has a V-type engine or an S-type engine, then it would be better to use HP as the independent variable. Right, so this is how we can implement logistic regression in R. Right, now, and this brings us to the end of the video. So let's have a brief recap of what we went through. So we started off by understanding what exactly is regression. Then we understood what is logistic regression. And finally, we implemented the concept of logistic regression in R.
Thank you for watching the video. Do like and share it. If you have any questions, comment below and we'll respond to them as soon as possible. Also, do subscribe to Intellipaat channel so that you can keep yourself updated on the latest technologies. You can also go through other related videos in our playlist. And for more information, visit our website. Keep learning, keep improving.